Welcome to WeekdayChurch.com, and thank you so much for joining us. We're going to do 2 weeks here back-to-back on politically themed messages. This first week's going to be messages that are a little farther away from home, big picture ideas. The second week's going to be things that really talk about where you are in your life. I wouldn't call them political issues, except that they've become hot-button political issues. And we're going to see what does the Bible actually have to say about these things. It doesn't always agree with where our culture is. Sometimes it does. Sometimes it agrees with our culture more than it does where much of the church is, actually. And we'll see that on some of the week's teachings, too. So thank you so much for joining us. Let's go ahead and open a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you for giving us your unchanging scripture. Heaven and earth may pass away, but your word will not pass away. We can stand on your word. You are immutable. You are unchangeable. God, you are forever God. Our thoughts change. What we think is good today, we think is bad tomorrow. And God, we are shifting like the wind. God, may we find an anchor in you. It's in the name of your son, Jesus, that I pray. Amen. Well, I'll see you right after this first video clip, and we'll get into the message.
Heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
I heard about his healing.
I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing. Made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory, yeah. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and brought me.
have two scripture passages today. The first one is from Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 31. Jesus says, "But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. To the one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from the one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them." Well, you see the guiding principle there is that last principle. It's the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It is a principle that really sums up the entire Old Testament, Jesus said, in this, that if you would do unto others as you would have them do unto you, you are living out what the Old Testament was trying to teach you. If you would love God and love others, as it says, those are the two greatest commandments. Well, that's pretty much it. It's pretty simple. And it says, you know, how do you do that? And he says things that are rather revolutionary. Give to anyone that asks of you. That's not popular in the world today, but I think it's even less popular in the church, especially in the American church today, where it's, well, they need to get out there. And again, we're talking about the politics that have invaded on things. And so much in conservative churches, conservative politics is also in there. And the conservative politics is saying, well, you know, they need to get a job. They need to just get out there and figure things out. They got to stop being a bum. You know, I mean, this is the thing that's messing them up. You know, if a man doesn't work, he shouldn't eat. And not thinking of any difficult time that might not come up on him, not thinking of any unforeseen circumstances, not even asking, actually, just saying, well, who cares? Well, Jesus' teachings were then revolutionary, and they're still revolutionary, with the main thought being, do unto others as you'd have them do to you. One of the teachings in there that he gave was our theme for today of turning the other cheek. That if someone hits you on the one side of the face, turn the other side of the face to them. Most of us aren't real good at doing that. Now, I know most of us haven't been in a physical altercation in a long time. Maybe some of you never were in a fist fight, and you have no idea where this is coming from, of having someone hit you as hard as they could, right up the side of the face, and then thinking, I'm just going to, you know, meekly turn the other side to them and see what they do there. Most of us, though, are regularly in emotional entanglements, are regularly in fights of all different kinds, even if they're not physical. And what he's saying is, don't strike back to other people when they strike out to you, but step back and be patient, be forgiving, let it go, drop the issue. What a wonderful application. And before we move on to the political statement that this is making and that I've seen people turn this into, what I want to say is, the application is that simple. Forgive. Jesus makes it even more blunt. He says, if you do not forgive others when they do things like this to you, then I won't forgive you when you sin against me. He says, you know, there's not really any option here. You have to just sort of let these things go. You can't react every time somebody does something to you. You have to show forgiveness. You have to do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. You've said and done things that you should have never said and done. And boy, wasn't it great when the person on the other side just sort of dropped it, let it go. Showed forgiveness and kindness and patience. Now, I've seen this taken over, as we said we're going to talk about this week, on the political side, of that nations should always turn the other cheek, that government should turn the other cheek, that the court system and the cops should always turn the other cheek. Now, we need to understand that this is a passage aimed toward the individual who is trying to live for Jesus Christ, not toward government systems, not toward big branches of people, but toward one person who's been mistreated and is going to stand up and say, as a follower of Jesus, I'm going to do what he would do, which is, I'm going to let this go. It says that he went to the cross as a sheep goes to the slaughter without saying a word. And it says that's how you're supposed to live. On the other hand, I want you to look at this passage that actually is speaking to the government in Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 4. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is a servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Now we'll talk about war and other things as we continue in the week. But this here is more talking about the government dealing with its own citizens, although it would also hold true to war, of the idea that God has put them in their authority and God has given them the sword, the power, if you want to call it today, the gun, the power to execute judgment and to be in charge and to say, God put us here. And what you did is wrong. Not only according to the laws of God, but according to the laws of our nation, which other men, including you, helped bring into existence. You and everyone else has to live according to these laws. You're not above these laws. And that they have the authority from God to bring judgment on that. And to say that they are to turn the other cheek, the Bible makes it very clear that if we let things like murder and rape go rampant through society, what will happen is that the blood will gather all through our society and will cry out from the streets looking for justice and looking for judgment, and that there will be no justice. What we are clearly taught in the Bible is that if a man sheds another man's blood, it is by his blood shall also be shed. Not by God, it says, but by man. This was instituted way back in the time of Noah. This is not just a law of Moses or an Old Testament law. Those came from the time of Moses and were Jewish laws. And no, we do not live under the Jewish laws anymore. But this was long before the Jewish laws. Noah comes long before that. All the Jews understand that all Gentiles and Jews are held to the law that God gave Noah and Adam, and those early patriarchs that came before Moses. The laws of Moses were for the Jews. The laws before, and the ones that Jesus gave, were for everyone. That's what the difference is here. And when you look at what a government has the authority to do, it is not to turn the other cheek, or blood runs rampant. And you do not discipline the evildoers. And that doesn't only include with murder, but with any of the things that the government is supposed to be able to do. So do not mix these two passages. What God is saying and turn the other cheek, he's saying to you and to me as individuals. What he is saying here in Romans 13, he is saying to the government that they have the power and the authority, and they were placed there by him to accomplish the work of disciplining and governing and ruling the people that God put in each nation. So governments have the authority to make decisions about what they do domestically, and not only what they do domestically, as we'll see as we continue through the week, what they do in foreign policy dealing with other governments too. That does not mean every war is a just or holy war, but it doesn't mean everyone is not either, and that there's never a time to take up the sword that God gave them.
Everyone considered him the coward of the county. He'd never stood one single time to prove the county wrong. His mama named him Tommy, the folks just called him Yellow. Something always told me they were reading Tommy wrong. He was only 10 years old when his daddy died in prison. I looked after Tommy, 'cause he was my brother's son. I still recall the final words my brother said to Tommy. Son, my life is over, but yours has just begun. Promise me, son, not to do